Hi, I'm Lynette Pearson, and this is the Video Voters Guide, a service of the League of Women Voters, a 102-year-old nonpartisan organization that believes democracy depends on informed and active participation. For more election information, please be sure to visit our website, vote411.org, before you mark your ballot. Today, we have Ben Edtl, running for Oregon State Senator, District Number 19. Welcome, Ben.
Thanks for having me today.
Oh, you bet. Tell us a little bit about your experience and why you're choosing to run for office.
Well, I was a small business owner in Portland. We had some cafes throughout the city. We had three cafes and a coffee roastery. And we lost our business in 2020 with the lawlessness and the lockdowns and you know, a whole bunch of other crazy stuff that really began in 2020. And in 2021, I decided to start a group called Free Oregon. We were a 501c4, and we grew very fast. We grew about 20,000 members, and we got very active as citizens into politics. And we took Kate Brown to federal court. We took Pat Allen and the Oregon Health Authority to federal court, and really got involved around the state to just push back against these policies and hold the politicians accountable that defunded our police and really went to work on our First Amendment rights. And so that was the basis of Free Oregon. So that's my experience.
Thank you. What are your top two priorities in running for office?
My top two priorities are gonna be the public safety. That is number one. We've seen essentially a humanitarian crisis in Oregon. My opponent, Rob Wagner, who's the Senate Democrat majority leader, he has passed over 14 bills that defunded and demoralized the police and prevented the police from stopping riots, prevented the police from arresting criminals. Bail reform was another one that was passed last year that actually prevented Measure 11, people who are arrested for Measure 11 crimes, prevented them from being held on bail. So they're getting just released. Kate Brown and the legislator did nothing to stop this, but Kate Brown let out 1,000 prisoners from OSP, and some of them were very violent offenders, murderers, rapists. This got unleashed into our communities. And today, as we can see in the Portland metro area, not so much in Lake Oswego and West Lynn, where the police departments have been able to you know, maintain law and order fairly well, but in Portland, which is also a big part of my district, the communities there are beholden and held hostage by criminals that have seemingly more rights than the taxpayers do.
Thank you. There are over 1,200 indigent criminal defendants who do not have access to public defenders. How would you propose to provide sufficient public defenders for people who cannot afford a lawyer as required by the Constitution?
Look, I think that the true balance in our court systems isn't by race or by gender. It's by how much public defenders earn versus how much district attorneys earn. A public defender in our state may have a caseload of up to 70, maybe even 80, sometimes over 100 cases, but not the district attorneys. So they're far more prepared going into court. If we want to balance the scales of justice in our courtrooms, we have to give more funding to public defenders so that we can equalize the resources on behalf of people who are accused of crimes that may not be able to afford, you know, the greatest lawyer. I think we've seen this over and over and over, that the issue is not race and gender. The issue is economics. And so we have to take economics out of our criminal court system if we want our court system to be more fair. And I plan to do that for Oregonians.
Thank you. Voters overwhelmingly indicated that they wished for campaign finance limits by changing the Oregon Constitution in November 2020. And so far, no legislation has been passed in either House or the Senate to limit campaign finance. Would you propose or support would you propose or support legislation to provide campaign finance limits, and what would those limits be?
Well, I'll tell you right now, the supermajority holders, the Democrats in Salem, were too busy passing laws that prevented local municipalities from removing homeless camps from public property. They were too busy passing over 30 different laws, including the CAT tax, that made Oregon the fifth most expensive state to live in the nation. And so, of course, they're not going to pass campaign finance limits. I think even just to the question at this point, you know, the metro area in Portland is facing a humanitarian crisis. You know, these people in Salem legalized hard drugs like fentanyl and meth and heroin, and people are dying in our streets. And you can see that the homeless crisis is out of control. They Rob Wagner and the Senate Democrats and the House Democrats as well, with Tina Kotek, they passed Measure 110 and didn't appropriate any funding for treatment. And as a result of that, Oregon ranks number one in overdose deaths and number 50 to access to treatment. So we got to address these issues before we look at any other issues.
Actually, that's a nice lead into our next question, which was about Measure 110, that the personal possession of most drugs in Oregon has been decriminalized. And this measure also included a component to provide behavioral health treatment to those individuals found in possession. Do you feel that the behavioral health portion of that measure is being adequately implemented? And if not, what would you do?
I'll tell you this right now. The Measure 110 that was implemented basically states that when someone's caught with possession of a hard drug like fentanyl or heroin or methamphetamine, they're given a ticket and they have an option to turn that ticket in for treatment. My understanding is that it's been widely reported, even starting as early as this week, that only one person in the entire state took them up on their offer. Look, it was an insane measure to begin with, because alcoholics and addicts do not get sober from a ticket. They don't get cleaned up from a ticket. If you know anything about addiction, addicts need to have very severe consequences for their behaviors in order to get the help that they desperately need. Otherwise, they run the risk of killing themselves and other people right along with them. That's one part of the tragedy of addiction. We have to give judges the leverage to force addicts and alcoholics into treatment in lieu of jail. And they had that to begin with. So Measure 110 send us backwards to a place where I hope we never, ever have to go back again. The first thing that I would try to do in relation to this issue is I would actually go repeal that bill and make sure that we can save some of the lives of the people who are dying in our streets with needles in their arms. It's a tragedy.
Thank you very much. Next question on voters' minds. Oregon state legislators receive a salary of around $33,000 a year for essentially what has become a full-time job. How do you feel about raising salaries to encourage candidates who do not have outside income?
Well, I think $33,000, everybody knows $33,000 a year is not very much. I mean, I just saw an advertisement at the local Taco Bell saying they're paying that much for people to come work at night. So, I mean, I think it's important that we raise these salaries, but let's look at some bigger issues here. The Oregon Health Authority, think about this. The Oregon Health Authority is a $40 billion a year government pig that does nothing but pass laws and regulations against our First Amendment rights. And it essentially, it does more things than that, but $40 billion, it's 40% of the entire state's budget. We need to cut where cuts need to be due, especially the Oregon Health Authority or the Oregon Department of Education, which are just bloated and tyrannical, and start getting better people into public office so that we don't go through what we went through for the last 2 years. I mean, I think a big part of this is that we have very incompetent people in Salem thinking that if they defunded the police, somehow our societies and our communities would improve. Now, that's insanity.
Well, in closing, what would you like to tell voters?
I want to tell voters that 71% of the kids in Oregon cannot test to grade level in mathematics. 60% of the kids in Oregon can't read and write at grade level. Now, Rob Wagner, my opponent, has all the big teacher union's endorsements, but he passed 15 bills to replace basic reading, writing, and arithmetic in our schools with critical race theory and comprehensive sex education and all kinds of other nonsense. And now our kids can't read and write, okay? So this is really, really bad stuff. We got to get these people out of here. We need to bring parents back into our education system. Wagner, the Senate Democrats, the House Democrats, they passed a bill that actually made it so that school boards couldn't fire superintendents. And I think that that's terrible, because what it does is it takes away the taxpayers, the local parents and the taxpayers, from when they elect a school board member, that school board member has no recourse if the superintendent doesn't execute the policies of that school board. So essentially what that's done is centralized all of our local public schools to the Oregon Department of Education, which is so woke that they're failing our kids in an unprecedented way. We've never seen this before. Oregon has always been in the top 10. And so I think voters need to be aware that when you get the teachers union endorsements, it doesn't mean that you're looking out for the kids. In fact, it means just the opposite. I have Parents' Rights in Education. I have the Oregon Moms Union. I will bring parents back into our public schools.
Ben, thanks so much for talking to us today. And voters, don't forget to visit vote411.org for complete candidate and ballot measure information. Thank you for joining us.